Hi everyone, thank you Kieran, thank you to all the team behind this conference. It's really a great pleasure to be here for this first Node conference in Europe. So following up on Max and Joe and the great insight that they shared about how to build products and companies using JavaScript and Node, I'm going to conclude this full stack Node track by presenting you the Joricat project. In this talk, I'm going to try to highlight how we've been progressively connecting the dots and basically trying to use JavaScript and Node for pretty much everything in our company, from the hardware to the cloud. So just to give you a little bit of background and tell you the story of about what we are, why we are doing all this. My partner Jerry Krim and I, in 2009, were basically looking for our next adventure. And what we were seeing is that a mass migration to the cloud was just beginning. There was the rise not only of the cloud as we know it with farms of server from big companies, but more importantly the rise of the personal cloud, because we are the generation that put all our data progressively online and we use mostly web apps. But still, all the laptops and all the devices that we were using were like more and more cheap, and still, they were using traditional software that were not really tied to the cloud. So the challenge we tried to tackle was how to reinvent the operating system for people who live in the cloud. Because we knew the cloud would be the most important change in the industry. We wanted to use the open web platform technologies to try to reinvent the way and make the cloud more simple and open for everyone. So that's pretty much how we started the company, a small team in Paris, trying to disrupt big software companies. So clearly, people thought we were kind of crazy. But anyway, so we created the first web store, and progressively we created JolyOS, which is a cloud-based operating system. And we even sold this computer, the JolyBook, as a limited edition in the UK. And still, our ambition was bigger than that, because when you live in the cloud, the OS actually needs to reside in the cloud as well, where your data is. Back to the technology, I played with Node in the early days, and I met Ryan Dow early 2010. And we had great discussion about the future and how Node could disrupt the way we think programming. And at the time, he was still the only committer on Node. And not long after, we started prototyping our platform and decided to go all the way with JavaScript on Node at JolyCloud. In 2011, we tried to start gathering the community of JavaScript and Node in Paris by organizing the first Node meetup. Ryan came along as a guest speaker. As you can see, he was working on libuv at the time, so the JavaScript attendees had like VI and C crash course. Funny times. And the reason I'm speaking here today is because Node has been the cornerstone of all our development since then. So JolyCloud today consists in three main core components. The first one being the start page, which is a full-featured web application. We embedded this web app in an OS called JolyOS, and the third part is the JolyCloud platform connecting you to all the clouds. So what I'm going to do is walk you through those three parts and see how we've been leveraging JavaScript and Node on all these levels. So first we have the JolyCloud desktop, the web application. So without diving too much into the details, since this is more front-end oriented, early on, we've been pushing the boundaries of browsers and trying to use as many HTML5 APIs as possible to create the best user experience for our consumers. And even if it's a front-end project, the interesting part is that Node is actually part of our front-end tools. And using Grunt, even if it's not like always the right approach, or we have makefile and jakefile for all these things, we found actually that Grunt helped our team to be more efficient and creative in terms of deployment of the front-end app. So obviously we've been able to reuse all the tasks created by the community for like JS linting, CSS minification, and so on. But we've also created some specific deployment tools on Node for JolyCloud. For instance, we created a task to produce Retina assets, so the app can look great on iPad and on Retina MacBook Pros. We also created tasks for encoding images, so the small ones in Base64 and inline them directly in the style sheets. And we also created some tasks to generate app cache manifest so the app can work offline, but a few others like to pre-compile the client-side templates. So here we have now a Joli Cloud application, full-featured, HTML5 and JavaScript-based, and that can work offline. The next step for us has been to think about the way we use computers, because if we live in the cloud, we have all this legacy software on our machine that we no longer use. So why not just reinvent what we have and just keep what matters, so basically put directly to the cloud. But still, we wanted to leverage the local resources of the machine, because even if you have all your data and your web services online, you still want to access your computer. And for instance, if you plug external media, or if you want to like shut down or restart the machine. So how could we possibly do that? Because W3C is working to make the browser more capable with the device API, the device API working group. And there is as well Firefox and Google more recently that are trying to add new APIs inside the browsers. But on our side, we wanted to have something working and ship this to our consumer. So how did we do that? Here is how Joli OS works. And the interesting thing is that we've been using the Chromium technology on Linux even before Chrome OS ever existed. So what we did is we took Chromium on top of the Linux kernel, the early dev builds that we compiled, and the most interesting part of this was the WebSocket protocol that just arrived in the browser. With the WebSocket protocol, we could establish a bi-directional communication between the web app, the front end, and the hardware. So what we did is that we wrote all these APIs to access the file system, devices, the apps, the session, and on top of them all, we created the WebSocket server so we can interact from the JS app. At the beginning, was not even out there when we started, so we used Python and C for most of the APIs. But then when Chris Williams, the founder of JSConf, created Node Serial Port, a whole new range of possibilities started to come from Node, because we could actually interact with the hardware. And you saw Michael this morning talking about the flying robots. So we went back to the drawing board and were like, is it really possible to use JavaScript on Node even on the computer? And the answer is yes. And to go further, what we did is inside the front-end application, in order to abstract the WebSocket protocol and not have to dive into low-level stuff, we created an API to both send command and subscribe to events happening on the computer. So for instance, you could just have a function to shut down or restart the machine, and on the other end, you could like subscribe to events to be notified when a USB key is plugged, for instance, and right away, you would have the signal in the browser. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to try to do a little demo, if the Wi-Fi is working properly. So here I have the Joli Cloud desktop. And what I did is I just passed a parameter with the IP address of this computer here that has an experimental build of Joli OS with like running Node. And I have here a USB key. So the WebSocket servers, the WebSocket server and the APIs are running on this machine. And this desktop is connected with WebSockets on this machine. So I'm going to try to plug this USB key on this computer. And here we go. Over the air, using WebSockets, this desktop is controlling this machine. And if I click here on my USB key, I can even browse the content of my USB key using WebSockets, abstracting the API of the hardware. And we can even go further. We can stream videos. Right now the key is we are streaming with a Node server over the air the content of a video on my USB key from this computer. Thank you.
I tried.
cool movie, by the way. Here we go. And we can go further. If you have a look at the computer from here, I can even remotely shut it down. I don't want to do the updates. Just shut it down right away. And here we go. So, a few days ago, Alex Sexton coined the term of polyfill for when we try to do polyfill for APIs that don't exist yet. And that's pretty much what we've been doing here, trying to define an API in the browser that's abstracting the low-level layers on the hardware. So here we have now an HTML5 app running offline and an OS that puts directly to the cloud to this app, bridging the gap between the HTML5 app and the local resources of the machine. And what's cool with that is that we've had a lot of success with kids in education and schools. Lots of schools actually told us that they installed this OS to teach kids programming and so on. So that's really cool. But for us, we wanted to go further, because if we live in the cloud, and if all our data lives in the cloud, it also means that the OS has to reside in the cloud. So that's what we're trying to do with the first part, with the Shelly Cloud platform, trying to bridge and to bring the clouds together so we can create the tools of freedom for the users, because our life online is fragmented. So this is the architecture of our platform. It's entirely based on Node from the ground up. So we have a caching system talking to Redis. Then we have, on top of that, an API. The API is mostly based on top of Express and Connect. It's a JSON API. On top of that, we have many platform internals that are talking to MongoDB. We have also a system for notifications to Apple and Google. And emails. So I have to admit that at the beginning, when we started this project, the interaction between the platform and MongoDB was pretty hard, because we were using Mongoose and under the hood, the MongoDB native driver. But at the time, it wasn't supporting the replica sets, for instance. So when we moved to production, it was quite hard. And it was also really hard to simulate the failovers and so on. But fortunately, things have been improving over time. So it's quite good now. The only part of the platform internals that we had to move out of Node was an image proxy that was responsible of scaling, resizing, cropping images. And clearly, Node was not made for that. But still, we tried to have all our stack in JavaScript, but we knew it wouldn't scale. So that's the only piece we moved out of Node. And then we have the Jolly Cloud modules, which is one of the most interesting parts. To talk to every single cloud, we try to use a modular approach to link to Facebook, Picasa, Google Drive, and the whole range of cloud services that we are using nowadays. We've abstracted a few helpers and some tools so that every single module could be as tiny as possible. And what I'd like to show you now is a quick move to Cloud9 here to show you how we've been integrating SoundCloud inside Jolly Cloud. So here is our package.json file, really basic, nothing fancy. Here we have in the dependencies the Jolly Cloud module, which is where we've abstracted all our helpers to create some modules for Jolly Cloud. In SoundCloud.js here, we have a sample API client. We are requiring our Jolly Cloud module that's exposing the host to an authentication method. We have here a constructor. So we are just creating a consumer with the proper URLs to the SoundCloud API. At the very bottom of this file, we have this function called request that is interacting with the SoundCloud API. So it's handling the paginations and different parameters, and that's pretty much where the SoundCloud API logic resides. So we have like data parsing, okay, really tiny, really easy, and we're just exposing the SoundCloud function here. And finally, we have the jolicloud-soundcloud.js file, which is just doing the binding between the JolyCloud platform and the SoundCloud web service. So here I'm requiring an item, because since we're trying to create some sort of operating system in the cloud, we have to create some sort of file system approach. So what could be a file that we call here an item? And we're requiring our SoundCloud.js library. At the very bottom, we have something really easy to simply link JolyCloud and SoundCloud account, just mapping some user data and linking with our function on the consumer. On top of the file, we have here a function called MapTrack, simply to create, as it sounds, a mapping between a track on SoundCloud and the JolyCloud item. So here it's an item, so it's a kind of music. We have a few parameters, a few attributes here, like URL, source, ID, name, description, really easy. A set of images, and also the embed URL. And that's pretty much it. So, wrote it quickly before the conference, and now we can go back to the actual product to see how it looks. So here I'm inside SoundCloud. I can see my stream now, I can see my favorites, and if I start typing a file, here we go. Little CSS free craziness here to play the files. And here we go, that's basically to integrate SoundCloud inside JolyCloud. Thanks. And the reason why I've showed you this code is because today I'm happy to announce that we are opening the JolyCloud platform to you guys and to all the Node community. What it means is that everyone will be able to write its own Node module for the JolyCloud platform, and will be able to embed them and let the cloud more open, basically. So we're just getting started here. We just launched developers.jolycloud.com, and over the next few weeks, the plan is to open source all our modules, as well as publishing some documentation. But have you seen, it's going to be really easy to write a module, just like 100 or 200 max lines of JS. And in a second time, what we also want to do is to open up the whole API that lets you access all the clouds at once, and that we are using to create our JolyCloud HTML5 desktop. So to recap quickly, we've been able to create with JavaScript a full-featured HTML5 app that works offline. Then, using Node and WebSocket protocol and JavaScript, we have an OS that boots directly to the cloud, so that basically remove all the constraints from the old world of the operating system. You just go directly to the cloud in a few seconds. And then we have a Node stack to create some sort of operating system that lives in the cloud and bringing all the clouds together. And that's what enables you to have all your clouds in one place. So, based on that, I think when Brandon and I said always test in JavaScript, that's pretty much the motto we've been following at JolyCloud since the beginning, using JavaScript everywhere to create from the hardware to the cloud and the front end, obviously, everything we've been doing. And to conclude, I want to thank you all. For all the modules and the vibrant community that we all have, because without all the contributions of everyone, we wouldn't have been able to create those cool consumer products. So Node is really paving the way towards a new way of thinking, a new way of programming, and I think it's great to be part of this constantly evolving ecosystem. And yeah, I hope this talk will inspire you to create great stuff in Node, in JavaScript, and to create beautiful consumer products.